Hello and welcome once again to all of my brilliant students. We're on lesson 8 of unit 1, our short story unit, and today we're going to be talking about characterization. So today the objective is that you will be able to identify, and not just identify, but also be able to analyze and be able to see how it plays into the different roles and the different components of a short story and how an author will use characterization, all right? So, first question is this, how is it that a writer can create a character on a page and make the readers feel as if they have met a real person? The answer to that question is characterization. The way a writer reveals a character is called characterization, and it's all about showing you all of the different character traits of a particular character, okay? Now, poor characterization can make a character uninteresting because that character may lack us any focus or clarity. Just as an example, a good characterization creates a clear picture in the reader's mind. So look at this guy, right? So I have a full sentence here, and it says, dressed in a costume, the matador prepared for the charging bull. Kind of boring. You don't get really a whole lot about your matador in that sort of scenario, do you? But if I change it up a little bit, dressed in a colorful blue and yellow costume, the matador prepared his satin cape for the charging bull. There's a lot more detail. There's a lot more there's a lot more interest that is being generated the more textured or the more detail that you can present giving your character, okay? So let's go ahead and let's just do this really quickly. Let's practice, okay? I want you to read through this with me, and I want you to identify everything that tells you something about Tommy McSweeney, all right? So Tommy McSweeney really hated being the tallest boy in the eighth grade. Everyone assumed he was a good basketball player, but he had no athletic interest or skill. Instead, his talent emerged far from a court or ball field, and no one beyond Tommy's family knew that the pale, muscular kid with curly hair and freckles was a classical pianist, and Tommy intended to keep it that way. I see multiple things that are going on here, right? I see thoughts and feelings whenever it says that Tommy hated being the tallest boy in the eighth grade. So we know that he's tall. We know that he's a boy. We know that he's in the eighth grade. It says that everyone assumed he was a good basketball player, but he has no athletic interest or skill. Let's see. He is a... No one... Da, 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 da. We know that he is pale, muscular, curly hair with freckles, but he's also a classic pianist, and we also have some of his final thoughts here that Tommy intends to keep it that way, right? So you can see how efficient and you can see how a good writer can efficiently create a full portrait of who their characters are, right? Like, and this is only what, about maybe 3-4 sentences, and within those 4 sentences we actually end up knowing a whole lot about Tommy, and that is through the different types of characterization there. Now, there are 2 types, count them, all right? 2 types of characterization. There is, first of all, direct characterization and indirect characterization. So if a writer prefers to show characters in action, that method is called indirect characterization. So one of the classic rules of writing that I would like to tell you guys this is that don't tell your audience, don't tell the people who are reading your stories, show them. Don't tell what your character is feeling. Don't say just flat out what your character is saying or feeling or thinking. Show through action. Show through verbs. Show what your character is doing. It's the rule is show, don't tell, okay? The first one, though, is direct characterization, and that is the telling. So if a writer tells you that a character is mean-tempered or they're friendly, that is direct. It's telling you exactly whether they are mad or glad or sad. And when a writer uses direct characterization, you don't have to do any detective work to figure out the character whatsoever, right? And so you're just blatantly saying, hey, this character is this way, okay? Now, that is, to be honest with you, considered to be a little bit juvenile, okay? So you would expect maybe a fifth grader to write, Tommy did this, Tommy felt this, Tommy felt sad, right? Like, it's a little bit juvenile, right? Well, you're not fifth graders, you're 10th graders. So it's time now that you guys began expounding on that, and you guys expanded your ability, and you guys began developing those skills. Show me in your writing whether your character is sad or mad or glad. Don't just tell me those things, okay? So we have an example here of some direct characterization, and it says, when Amaya brought home a pet rabbit, her mother did not object. She knew Amaya was a caring, responsible girl who would take excellent care of the animal. What does this tell you directly about Amaya? It's not so much about Amaya bringing home a pet rabbit, right? It's not so much that Amaya has a mom, right? What does this tell you exactly about Amaya's character traits? Well, it says that she is caring, responsible, and she would take excellent care of the animal, right? No sleuthing there. We didn't have to go prodding around through the text trying to figure out what this character trait of Amaya is. We know that she's caring and responsible. But writers generally prefer to use indirect characterization. And when writers use indirect characterization, they show their characters in action, giving readers the chance to decide for themselves what a character is like. So I have this great animation here of Finn and Jake from Adventure Time. And so if I was writing this out, right, I could use direct characterization and I could say Finn was happy and Jake was happy. Okay, they saw something that made them happy, or and that's me telling you, or I could show you in my writing and I could say, with a sudden grin, Jake leapt into Finn's arms as they both laughed spontaneously looking out across the cave. Okay, like it doesn't, like, one of those sounds a lot more interesting, doesn't it? Like whenever it's just like Jake is glad, Finn is glad, right? Boring. Don't be boring in your writing, okay? Use indirect characterization. Now, there are five types of indirect characterization, and those five types are appearance, actions, words, thoughts and feelings, and relationships. And we're going to talk about each one of those, okay? So the first thing I want to talk about is appearance. So through exact physical details, a writer can imply, suggest, a character's personality, right? So, how is the character dressed? What is the character's posture? What is the character's facial expression? Are they clenching their hands? Are there tears rolling down their eyes? Are they wearing a coat? All of those things have to do with their appearance, right? And also, whenever it comes to appearance, that's where you oftentimes see symbolism that are attached to characters. I'm going to pull up a picture here really fast. So, what we have here is one of the original Star Wars poster for Star Wars A New Hope, and I just want you to look at some of the appearances of the characters, right? We have five characters on this poster, and we have Luke and Leia, and of course, back here in the background, we have Darth Vader, and then we have the droids over here, right? And all of our protagonists are all in the same sort of motif, right? If you were to describe their appearance, I would say that they are kind of Grecian, like they kind of look like something out of a Greek or Renaissance painting. They're definitely wearing white. You know, from the movie, that Luke oftentimes throughout all of A New Hope, he's wearing white for the most part, whereas Darth Vader is wearing like these dark colors. He's wearing like just this matte black. And in addition to that, Luke has a nice, cool green lightsaber that he eventually like trades out for a blue one. Or was it the other way around? No, Obi-Wan had the blue one and then Luke got the green one. And then Darth Vader has like this menacing red lightsaber, right? And so with those colors, with those appearances, like you can see Luke and Leia's face. Darth Vader wears a mask. Luke and Leia talk and there's no filter, but you know that like there's a filter even whenever Darth Vader breathes, like, so all of these things that have to do with the appearance kind of help to contribute to the nature of who that character is and what George Lucas, the director, wanted you to think or believe about that character. You knew that Darth Vader was a bad dude the moment that he comes walking on to that Cerulean, what is that? Corellian escort. Like, as soon as he goes onto that ship, you know he's a bad guy, and you know that Leia is the good guy. So appearance can be really, really important whenever an author is using it correctly. The next thing that I want to do is let's go ahead and let's practice this, right? Let's go ahead and practice this with the actual words, and I want you to be thinking about just the words that tell you about a character and just about that character's appearance, right? So the man seated in the parked limousine had short hair, piercing eyes, and a serious gaze. He was dressed neatly in a starched white shirt and striped tie. So picking out all of the things that have to do with his appearance. Short hair, piercing eyes, a serious gaze. He's dressed neatly. He has a starched white shirt and a striped tie. You might conclude that this is a wealthy or serious or very focused businessman, right? Because, you know, like, if you've ever had to go through the process of starching a shirt or getting your white shirt starched at a laundromat, like, it's not fun. It's not an easy process. Like, you gotta put in that little bit of extra effort, right? So yeah, you might be able to, just by looking at him, tell that this is a serious guy, a focused guy, right? The next thing is that actions reveal a great deal about people. So people's actions can show whether they're helpful or whether they're intelligent or mocking or sarcastic and many, many others. And in story, actions reveal personality just as much as anything else. So actions can reveal personality, it can reveal motivation, and it can reveal the circumstances, right? It can reveal all of those things about that particular character through not what they're saying, but simply what they're doing, right? Like our heroes would not be heroic if they didn't do heroic things, correct? Our villains would not be villainous if they just talked about being a villain all the time. Okay, that's cool. You talk a big game, but if they actually do something villainous, then they're proving with their actions the nature of their character, right? So let's go ahead and let's ascertain the character of this one of these characters, right? It was a cold October day when Christie's alarm buzzed at 6 a.m. She pulled on her clothes and headed for the door. She carefully adjusted her headphones, then she pulled the sleeves of her turtleneck over her hands to keep out the cold. Here goes 10 miles, she thought as she began her run. I have to be ready for the spring marathon. Now, if we are just looking at the things that she did, just the verbs, she pulled on her clothes, she goes out the door, she adjusts her headphones, and then she pulls the sleeves of her turtleneck over her hands and begins to run. So the things that I'm seeing just from her actions is that she's getting up. She's getting up early. I found that out here. She's getting up. She's getting up early. It seems like she likes music, right? And then she's probably, even if I'm just ignoring the cold October day, I know that it's probably cold out because she's pulling her sleeves over her hands in a turtleneck, right? So I can probably tell that Christie is probably a pretty intense runner, a pretty focused and determined runner, and that she's wanting to train. So let's go ahead and move on to the next bit of characterization. Up until this point, we have direct and indirect characterization, right? We have the five types of indirect characterization, and thus far, that's been appearance, action, and now we are on words. And a character's words are important because the exact words of a speaker reveal insight into their personality. For the longest time, people didn't know why Neville Longbottom was in Gryffindor, and then this happened.
And who might you be, young man?
Neville Longbottom.
Well, Neville, I'm sure we can find a place for you in our ranks.
I'd like to say something.
Well, Neville, I'm sure we'd all be fascinated to hear what you have to say.
It doesn't matter that Harry's gone.
Stand down, Neville.
People die every day. Friends. Family. Yeah. We lost Harry tonight. He's still with us. In here. So's Fred. Remus. Tonks. All of them. They didn't die in vain. But you will. Because you're wrong. Harry's heart did beat for us. For all of us. It's not over.
I still get chills. Neville always belonged in Gryffindor. It was by the power of his words and his actions that we knew he was always brave. So hopefully that brings home to you the power of words, how words can be so important, and how words can tell you exactly what the speaker is thinking or feeling or what their insights are. Moving on, though, let's go ahead and let's move on to thoughts and feelings, speaking of which. So characters' thoughts and feelings also reveal information about what they're like. So let's use this as an example. Frank insisted that he wasn't tired or hungry, but really, he was both. The long plane trip with 2 days left his patience in shreds. However, he didn't want Aunt Judy to go to any trouble, right? So we know that he's hungry, we know that he's tired, we know that his patience is in shreds, but he still doesn't want to bother his Aunt Judy. So I could say that Frank is probably a courteous guy. That would be one of the character traits that I could assume that he is, right? And so I wouldn't know that if I wasn't privy to his thoughts and feelings in the text. So the last thing I want to discuss is the character relationships. With indirect characterization, character relationships are used by writers who give their readers a view of their characters from another angle, the relationships with each other. And so how one character reacts to another character often reveals qualities of both of them, okay? We've talked about archetypes, and we've talked about characters standing in as an avatar oftentimes for the reader. And so sometimes whenever that character is scared or frightened or happy or joyful, that's one of the things that the author is hoping that you will pick up on, and hopefully you will feel the same sort of empathy and empathetically feel for that same character. So the way that you pick up on those relationships is you ask yourself, what are characters saying to each other and how are the characters acting toward one another? Okay, so here is our last bit of practice. Out of the five, there are three different types of indirect characterization here, okay? And I want you to read this through carefully, and I want you to help me pick these out, okay? I'm tired of being ignored, Mara thought. When I walk into a room, it's like no one sees me. No more. I'm going to get noticed at the dance. When the big night came, though, nothing went right. Mara's dress didn't fit correctly, and her shawl had a hole in it. Worst of all, as she walked into the gym, the heel broke on her right shoe, sending her sprawling across the floor. Woof, that sounds like my prom. Anyways, so you can see her thoughts here in the green, right? I'm tired of being ignored. When I walk into the room, it's like no one sees me. So those are her thoughts. The next bit that we see is we get a little bit of characterization through her appearance, right? Mara's dress didn't fit correctly. Her shawl had a hole in it. And then the last bit, the worst bit, is the action. When she walks into the gym and goes sprawling, tripping across the floor. Rough night at the dance, eh, Mara? So I hope that you can see all of the different types that an author can use indirect characterization to reveal character traits about their characters, okay? Remember, those five are going to be appearance, action, words, thoughts and feelings, and relationships. Okay, you're going to need to know that, and hopefully you'll manage to imbue some of your own characters with some characterization, revealing to your audience what your characters are like. I have complete and utmost faith in you guys. You guys are awesome, and don't stop learning, my brilliant students.